morning. I got to know Laura remotely. I met Laura remotely when one of my HR leaders recommended that I had a close look at work evolution in our laboratory in Europe on smarter work. We met each other at SIOP, the Society of Industrial and Organizational Psychologists. That was like about 2 years ago in Anaheim, right? But I was allowed in with other psychologists for about 4 days to forage and learn about what psychologists are doing. And they have actually come up with a fantastic tool to assess in the prospect of development of leaders, individual contributors, and teams. I think it's also a very, very good tool because I know some people are in the recruitment and selection business here in the room to actually do predictive statements about how people are good at working remotely. I say no more, and I'll leave Laura to talk about it. Here you go.
All right. My images are not quite our beautiful Rocky Mountains, but I wish I had a picture because I have a mountain view and we back onto a ravine and there are moose in our ravine, which is really cool, and deer and all of that. So really lucky to live where we do, but it is cold at times. And deep snow banks up to here. Yeah. But I find it colder in your conference rooms than I do back home. So I'm Dr. Laura Havley, and this is Dr. Tom O'Neill, my co-founder. And we're really excited to talk about what we've uncovered, so what Work Evolution has uncovered about leading from a distance. And we've been passionate about this topic for a long time. When I did my doctorate in industrial psychology, I specialized in leading from a distance. And that was in 2003 that I started doing this research along with Tom O'Neill, and I got involved in the whole adoption of telework and how the virtual workplace was growing, published this book back in the 2005 timeframe. And more recently, we developed a profile of what makes someone an effective remote worker, and we were in Scientific American magazine, so that was really exciting. But we've been on this whole journey about the human elements of working apart from one another. And we landed on the term distributed work, but it's really any of these ways of working. It's when a person is working apart from their leader, apart from their team, at least some of the time, and obviously activity-based work is a big component of this. And there's three groups that we look at. We look at employees, leaders, and teams, and we want to help each of these groups become more engaged and more productive. But there's a problem. This isn't the problem, this is the good thing. We're huge fans of distributed work, activity-based work. This is a really exciting direction that the world is heading, and 83% of organizations offer some type of distributed work. However, the problem is only 40% of employees receive support, training, development on how to make use of flexibility effectively. So it's like being pushed into a new way of working or being pulled into it because it's a good opportunity, but we're not given the right support and the right learning and tools and techniques to help this be effective. So then we get situations like this, okay? And Luke was talking about choice, and I agree 100%. People love having choice. That's one of the fundamental human motivators. So you give people the choice of working in a flexible, remote way. Maybe you save them the soul-sucking hour commute each way to work. And then you say, no, you're coming back into the office every day. I'm going to take away that choice. I'm going to take away the flexibility, and I'm going to take away your valuable time. It's a boomerang effect. It's what Yahoo and IBM did, and we believe that they had the technology to work from a distance, right? They have the technology and tools, and they have the space to allow people to come in certain days of the week, work from other locations other days. What they didn't have is the right leadership and team capabilities to make this work. It was a human dynamics issue, and it's a big mistake because the problem is this isn't going away. We have all of these different drivers, and since Tom and I started the research in 2003, these keep getting to be more and more profound, right? The technology we were studying and using back then, it's a million times better now, right? The war for talent is significant. Commute times are becoming longer and longer in the major cities. Environmental footprints are a big bigger and bigger issue with carbon emissions from all of these one-hour commutes each way, one person in a vehicle. So there's all of these issues that are only going to make it more prevalent. So what we look at is, today we're going to just talk about the leadership, because the way that I see it is, if the leaders aren't bought in and doing this the right way and leading people the right way, then it's not going to work. So we really love working with leaders, and leaders can be either formal leaders with direct reports, or they can be project leaders. They can be managing a project. But what makes them distributed leaders is when they're working apart from their people, at least some of the time. And a distributed leader can be at any level of an organization. Okay, they can be the CEO all the way to the project leader or the first-time supervisor. And strong leadership is definitely scientifically predictive of productivity, efficiency, engagement, lower turnover, and decreased absenteeism. So my job is working with leaders all the time, whether we're coaching, assessing, and I work with a lot of co-located leaders and a lot of distributed leaders, but leadership is hard work, okay? It's hard work, and it's a work in progress. But the fact of the matter is, to be a great distributed leader, you need to be a great leader, period, and you need all of the skills of a great leader, plus you need more. You need to be more intentional, you need to be harder working, and this is one of the most prolific teams researchers of all time from Harvard, Richard Hackman, who spent his career researching high-performance teams, and my business partner Tom is an expert in teams, and this quote by Hackman is an important one. It's much harder to create the conditions of success when you're leading from a distance. It's much harder. So that's where we come in, and we say, we can help with this, because this there's a recipe to do it well. Because there's all of these challenges. We're missing that water cooler, that informal interaction that a traditional office gives us. We don't have the non-verbals as easily, unless we're using video, and we fill some of that gap. But it's still not perfect. We have technology challenges. I mean, it's come a long way, but we still have the challenges, right, of the webinar conking out in the middle or whatever it may be. We have the challenge of building trust, right? And I think that trust is more difficult to build and easier to break when you're working apart. Mm-hmm. And trust is a hot topic these days. We've been doing lots of speaking on it and lots of training on with groups of leaders on building trust, because when it's damaged, it causes so many issues and problems. And when you're working apart, you can't lead on the fly as easily. You can't get away with lazy leadership, I call it. Lazy leadership means, my door is always open. Come and talk to me when you need me. That's lazy, right? That's not your job, to sit behind your desk and just wait around for someone to come and talk to you. And then building relationships, it takes more work, it takes more effort, and then building a cohesive team takes more skill. But we know through all of our research over the last 15 years that certain attributes and skills predict leadership capabilities. And knowing how a leader, how they might perform on certain capabilities when they're working from a distance with their people, it can help them develop and grow, it can help them through transition, and it can help them lead better teams. And then you save costly inefficiencies and turnover, right? So when a leader isn't prepared to do this well, it's inefficient, they're learning by trial and error, and they can lose good people. Okay, so again, we want leaders to do this well so that their people can thrive and the distributed work can stay and grow and flourish, like a biolithic office with plants growing. And we don't want to go back the way of Yahoo and IBM. So what we've done is we've built upon this research base where we've surveyed hundreds of leaders. We've done a lot of interviews of leaders from North America and Europe, including a great leader named Philip, who was one of our interviewees a couple of years ago. And we ended up with, 680 unique behaviors of distributed leaders. And Tom led that research project where we had to put that into a framework. And the framework was these 14 different capabilities of what makes a great distributed leader. We put it into language that is easy to understand. We like things to be practical. We like to have conversations about, okay, what do we do about it? And when I ask people and I say, how many of these apply to leadership in general? They say, all of them do, Laura. And I say, well, all of them do, but there's specific nuances when you're working apart from one another. And that's what we get at here. So there's these 12 areas of attribute. These are scientifically predictive of distributed leader success. Okay, so we go in and we assess their personality. They answer questions online. And we get at things like, are they naturally trusting? Some of us are wired to trust more naturally than others. It's a scientific fact. But if I know where a leader falls on that continuum, I can better address it point blank, and I can better support and coach and develop that leader. And it's fascinating when you see this all come together in a profile, and that's what we're doing at our session at South by tomorrow, and Philip's going to be the guinea pig, so he went through it. We're going to do a live coaching of Philip on this model. Skills, so it's not only the personality that matters, it's the skills of the leader. How organized are they? How effective are they at running virtual meetings? And that's a whole skill set we're talking about tomorrow in our session as well. Because we said if there's one thing we could talk about in our session, it's this. Because this is the number one factor that ties into a lot of distributed leader capabilities. Because so many distributed meetings are wasteful, inefficient, frustrating as heck, etc. So that's what we're tackling tomorrow. Communication medium match, that's, are you choosing the right media for your purpose or medium? Are you choosing to email when you really should be on something like Slack? Are you choosing to be on Slack when you should have picked up the phone? But we're all about, at Work Evolution, creating awareness for leaders and for employees and for teams, that creating self-awareness of my strengths and my gaps, and we all have them. Developing strategies around how to fill those gaps, and taking action. So we never like to leave a conversation with any leader without saying, what are you going to do differently starting tomorrow, right? Because assessments are fun and interesting, but an assessment will just gather dust or just be filed away in an electronic file if you don't take immediate action. Okay. So this is just a snapshot from our distributed leader profiler. We give feedback. Okay, what are bite-sized things that you can do? And I can't wait to hear the habits presentation, because I think it is about little things that you can change to make habits on a daily and weekly basis. What can you do differently? Keep it simple, keep it behavioral, and keep it easy to implement. And that's what we believe. And we always like to say, let's set a goal setting, an action plan, where if I ask you in a month from now whether you've done this thing, you can tell me yes or no. So a lot of times we like to set broad goals and visions, but unless it's tangible and specific, I don't want to see it. I want to break it down into the specific. So in summary, leading from a distance is hard, it's challenging, but there's skills, attributes, and capabilities that are scientifically proven to help through the science of psychology. And Philip was welcomed into the industrial organizational psychologist in Anaheim. They loved him. He just ate it up. I think that you should get an honorary doctorate one day. One day, we'll figure that out. But you can strengthen your leadership by gaining self-insight and applying habits. We're really happy to connect. We have all of these to give out later, but we have if you wanted to try our distributed work profiler, it's a fully automated interactive assessment that you can get results in real time. And there's videos to debrief it, but we also have a chocolate loonie on the back. So our $1 from Canada, which is a nice coin awesome. There for you. If anyone's interested, we're handing those out after. Thank you very much.